What's up? Welcome to day 372 of Making Summary. Look, my desktop's clean today. Woo! Such a nice feeling. After I do updates to the beta version and stuff like that, I like to clean up my desktop. It's kind of, I guess I'm kind of anal like that. What's up, Teak? Hey, Arcane, yo, what's up, people? Working on a menu refactor today. This is going to be so, I'm going to refactor some code, simplify some things so I can reuse this code for both the main menu and for the pause menu, because I want you to be able to access all the same kind of settings from the pause menu. So while you're playing the game, you can pause and then change your sound volume, change your music volume, change your input, even that kind of stuff. So that's today's goal, refactor the menu so it's simpler. It can be reused for the pause menu in game. What clicking noise? What are you talking about clicking noise? Zilton, what's up? I'm disturbing your movie night, huh? Freaking builders? Right? Who does, man? You got some crazy neighbors. Crazy neighbors. Zilton's got some crazy neighbors. Oh, clicking. Oh, I get it, Teak. You had the tab open and it started making sound. That's what it was like for you. That's crazy. Oh, it's at the bank. Yes, send a care package. Good move, man. Good move. Not only are you're gonna win some points for yourself, but also for your neighbor. Your neighbors are gonna love you. So what I'm simplifying here is this. I'm making a class called Interface, which is kind of taking all the things from the main menu and putting them into a simple class that can be reused. So this is now going to be interface.choices. And this is no longer a current choice. There's interface.choice. This is going to take forever. Let's do this the simple, fast way. So choices dot becomes interface dot choices dot replace. Yeah, I know. I'm always clicking things, right? Buffu, he's here. Don't threaten Buffu. But I know it's gonna work for you. You're gonna threaten Buffu. And then Bafu is just going to comply. All of a sudden, he's going to give you free parking again. Yo, PMC. Hey, man. How's it going? You're sending... Atix is trying the opposite strategy. You're sending flowers to Bafu. I wonder how that will work. Does Bafu like the sword or the pen? Or wait, is Bafu motivated by love or hate, man? All right, there. All those are refactored. Choices. Choices. What do you mean choices? Interface.choices. Yeah, everywhere that it says current choice is going to become interface.choice. Interface dot, here's where it actually steps it. It looks like the butter robot from Rick and Morty. Wait, which robot was that? The butter robot? Is it, wait, is that season three or two? Is there a season three yet? Did we? Yes, we already figured this out. That's what Skynet wants us to believe. Is no season three. That's what I thought. But I've seen both seasons. I don't remember a butter robot. Yeah, PMC, nice. You're working on your first game? Right on, man. Avast. Avast, salad dongs. What's up, salad dongs? Let's give this another heave ho. Use of unidentified identifier. Choices. Choices. Interface dot back. Interface dot back. Back call back. This becomes interface dot back. Rick needs a robot to bring in butter and just. Oh, that butter robot! Oh! I remember now. I remember the butter robot. That's right. Yeah, I totally. Menu. All right, so all the menus are now going to become interface.menu. You always wanted to make a game. Yeah, totally. Yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't really doesn't matter what you're creating at first, whether it's Pong or whatever. It's just you learn so much from making a game, you know? I think that just looped over. Oh, this one's not interface that menu. This one's just menu. Go down to these errors down here, fix more of these errors up. Hey, what's up, BitHext? So first I'm going in like fixing all these bugs and stuff, but then I'm gonna have to go kind of through each bit of this entire file here and get this all working with this new interface class. But once this is all kind of refactored, I should be able to run the menu again. It's gonna be a while. It's probably gonna be a half an hour to an hour of this stream just refactoring this code. So yeah, keep on going with these interface dots. Moving the cursor, this is kind of this function here should probably be up in. Yeah, this should be a method of interface, move cursor. Okay, so this move cursor moves to the current choice. Yeah, so this doesn't even need to be a method anymore of that. So interface is gonna have a function called move cursor. Title layer. Title scene. Title scene layer. It's a scene layer. Everybody knows it's not just a scene, it's a scene layer. Okay, so this function doesn't need remove item, doesn't need move cursor, doesn't need create choice even. Let's get that compiled. Yes. I love that quote. Oh, did I add a move cursor function? Oops. Move cursor. So if choices dies is less than zero, or the current choice is greater than or equal to. There we go. So if, yeah, if there's no choices or the choice is invalid, then we return. Otherwise, we're checking if the current item is enabled. Really, we need a set choice function. Yeah, okay. This needs to be called set choice. Wait. Everywhere we're setting the choice, is it moving the cursor as well? This is co choice equals zero where it shows the menu. This one really doesn't need cho This one really doesn't need choice equals zero there. But yeah, there it moves the cursor. There it moves the cursor. Yeah, so this would be a move cursor function. Tile scene. This should be called set choice to int something choice. And that'll automatically move the cursor and clamp the choice and all that. You lost your deadly code? What? Not the deadly code? Don't tell us you lost the deadly code. The deadliest code of them all. So choice equals items not equal to null. So there's two things going on here. It clamps the choice based on the number of choices, and it also increments the choice to the next available choice if that choice is not enabled. Oh, that code. The deadly code. Wait, Zilton, I might even have it on my log here. Hold on, let me see if I got it for you, buddy. This has like a really long scroll back here on my iPad. It's pretty nice. Come on, where's Zilton's deadly code? Ah, here it is. I found it, Zilton. Oh no! I found it, and then I accidentally clicked the wrong button, and it scrolled me all the way back down. Come on. Wait, where is it? There it is again. Come on, copy. So hard to copy things on a freaking iPad. Copy. Blam, I got it, buddy. There you go. That's the code you wrote yesterday. Let's see. Are you going to try it out? I really want you to try it out. Yeah, you got it, man. Yeah, so it's clamping and then it's also incrementing if it needs to. Anyways, if trying to think of a simpler way to make this function. But choices.size, let's just do this. If choices.size is greater than 0, you have a fun story? All right, I'm standing up and I'm relaxing. Hey, what's up, Overcaster? I'm good, man. How are you doing? I'm excellent. I'm doing what I love. Doing what I love and loving doing it. And choice is greater than or equal to 0. And choice is less than choices.size. Then we can do this whole check if the current item is enabled code. Which seems like a kind of a bad loop. I'm not sure if this is right. Like, really, does it need to do it if, whatever. There, choices.size, there we go, okay. So we'll say up here, choice equals new choice. Ah, yeah, we can do it this way, choice equals clamp. Clamp version. Is the game progressing as I'd like? Yes, it is, more than I would like. It's, well, no, not more than I like, just as I would like. Yeah, the game is progressing really well. Really, really well. Like, in my playthroughs, every time I do a beta update, I update to Steam, like, once a week. And, yeah, it's really great to go. Like, I'll go and I'll update it, I'll put it on Steam, I'll sit back, I'll smoke a bowl, and then I'll have, like, a just this nice playthrough session, right? And 6 months ago or so, Songbringer would still be fun for me. And I was like, cool, this game's pretty awesome. The procedural generation's sweet and stuff like that. But now there's so many more things in the game that's starting to make it really, really fun to play, even though I'm the one that's creating it and playing it every freaking day already. You know, so there's something special about this game, and I'm really excited to see how it turns out, you know, because it's not like, when a project gets enough momentum, it becomes a thing of its own, you know, and that's what Songbringer is starting to become. It's got a lot of momentum. It's its own thing. It's going in its own direction. It's almost as if it has its own free will. And so I'm excited to see what Songbringer wants to be. What does Songbringer want to become? And how does it want to entertain us? You know, what does it want to do? What is it going to look like when it's finally done? There. Yeah, we just clamp it here. Clamp it. You don't know how to test the code? What do you mean? Okay, so here we'll check it. We'll check the choice. Hold on. If choices.size is 0, this should never ever run. Actually, this should never ever run. Retron. I always type retron. Mighty Nest, I tried the latest Steam version and it runs so smoothly now. Oh, that's great. Oh, that's really great. Oh, that's awesome, Mighty Nest. I do remember adding some stuff to the Windows version so it would run more smoothly. And that was all thanks to this guy's great forum post on Cocos2DX's forums. And it was all about the Windows timer. There's some kind of timer thing with Windows where if you don't call this little timer function, your game can run at just random ass frame rates. And so if you set this timer function, it's so simple. It's like three lines of code, and all of a sudden your game runs a bajillion times smoother. So that's pretty cool. I'm hoping that that's what that was for you, because you're playing on Windows, right, Mighty Dust? Overcaster, have you hurdled the in-game lighting effects? What do you mean, hurdled the in-game lighting effects? A link to that? Do I have a link to that? A link to what? Oh, yeah, so yeah. Oh, do I have a link to working with shadows and bloom? You mean, like, what are some good resources about how to write your own shadows and bloom shaders? Oh, the forum post. Okay. Yeah, yeah. It's on discuss.cocos2dx.org. It's something I recently commented on. Here's my replies. Big window, small frame. No. Where was, what the hell is this? Here. Cocos2dx Windows performance issues examined. This is an excellent post. So good. Found it. All right. Let me post this on the Twitch chat. Teek, don't worry, man. You're only 999 points away. Some guy was calling devs that use GameMaker as an engine aren't real devs. I totally disagree with that person. Whoever said that you're not a real game developer if you're using GameMaker is a fool. Actually, it's just ego, man. Don't worry about it, PMC. That's somebody just making an egoic statement. Don't worry about ego. Yeah, ego goes around a lot in the geek scene, man. Yeah, and they don't know what they're talking about, right? You said show him the game, and he said it's on his school computer. Don't worry about that guy. Mighty Ness, is Coco's Creator any good? I downloaded but haven't got stuck in yet. I haven't tried Coco's Creator. I don't like any kind of game development software. It's a personal preference. I would rather have only source code. I don't want to deal with software. That's why I've never tried Coco's Creator or Coco's. That's why I don't like Unity. That's why I don't like Unreal. I don't like any engine where you have to use some kind of interface to write your game. I'd rather be able to be in Linux like this and using Vim to create my entire game if I want. And I'd rather have all the source code to the game. So if I want to, or if there's something in that engine I'm using that I need to change, I can. It's just a matter of going to the source code. I'm a programmer at heart. You can't ever change me. Can't change me. So yeah, but now we're just checking the choice. If the choice is less than choice is that size. Or if it's greater than or equal to. Yeah, I get put off when there's a game window you drag stuff into. Yeah, right? Yeah. What? Food? I'm here. I'm here. Looks all good here. Not a single drop frame. All right, Overcaster. So yeah, we've set the current choice. Now let's get it. So C is choices choice. Cursor, set color. Are we erasing? If we're erasing, okay, so this should need to be more abstract, more, now this needs to be part of this. Const, now see erasing. Default cursor color RGB. That's what we really, that's really the only constant we need here. 255. Six. 199. No, Teak, my internet's not good again, but I found some settings. I found some settings for my streaming software, which actually are really optimal. So basically, my stream settings are, I'm still at my crappy internet. It's just that I have some really great settings here. Like this is I'm at 720p, so at least it's HD. I'm at 15 frames a second, like it's always been. But my average bit rate is a little bit different. The quality and the settings for the way it's using the X264 encoder are just basically as optimal as possible to allow it to get as much quality out of the shortest or the lowest of bit rate I could possibly get. So yeah, that's thanks to a lot of tweaks. There's been a lot of tweaks to that. Lots of different streams is run at different settings to finally get that. Default cursor color. There we go. Jesus. Hey, what's up, Rocket Bunny? Heyo. Create cursor. Okay, so it starts the cursor off at K font color. Guess we'll keep it like that for a moment. And this bit here where it's erasing, I think it's probably better to just set the color of the cursor when it starts erasing. Jonah! What's up, Jonah? You've mapped out all the very basic game engine needs. Right on, Rocket Bunny! Such great progress you're making, man. I guess I could throw a bool erasing in here. Yeah, I guess so. Set choice, int choice, bool erasing. Default cursor color. All right, now for each choice, we have the menu item. We got to get that set. They're basically black boxes. I find it frustrating to not know what's going on under the hood. Yeah, exactly. Like, what the hell is this Unity doing under the hood? What are we making today, meth? Oh, man. Yeah, what I'm working on today is abstracting. I'm refactoring the menu code so that it can run in the game. So inside the, when you're in the game, you're playing it, you can pause and still go to like the window settings, the sound volume settings, the remap your input even, like do that kind of stuff all while you're in the game. And so I'm trying to write some code here which abstracts all that and makes it easy to reuse that. So I'm using the exact same code for the main menu as that I am for the in-game menu. I refuse. Hey, Rocket Bunny, nice. I'm glad you're realizing this. Yeah, true. Blue crystals? Is this what do you got there? CPH4? You're like Lucy. Is that the movie you were watching? Were you watching Lucy? Yeah, PMC, I agree, man. It really doesn't matter what engine you're using. It totally doesn't. I guess I could keep that check like that. Oh, you're watching absolutely anything. I don't know what that one is. By the way, about that, do you still use ECS with the menus? No, I don't use my ECS with the menus. No. I mean, yes, the menus actually access the ECS, but the menus themselves don't actually, they aren't like menu components or whatever. But I guess I could write that, right? Like I could create some different components that are only used for the menu. But I don't know. It might be kind of overkill to use the ECS for the menu. I don't know. Maybe that actually would simplify things though. I don't know. I have to think about that. Let's call this one I. If I.label is not equal to null pointer. I.label set color. This is animating all the other menu items whenever you move the cursor. My first game in C++ will be a really simple platformer. Nice, Rocket Bunny. Hey, oh, now you're trying the bowl of flowers, huh? Your friends and I found out how to use American Netflix. Right on. I forgot that's a thing. Does our Netflix here have like better Netflix or stuff? Like different choices, better streaming choices or whatever? So this is stop actions on other on all existing choices, and then here it's animate the current choice. You have 13,000 films. You only have 1,000? What? Whoa. Yeah, because of copyright and licensing. Wow. Certus, what's up? Sweden has a really good one, huh? Yeah, even ours here in America, it doesn't have like everything you'd want to watch sometimes. You're like, man, why did they take this off stream? But Battlestar Galactica, right? Why did they ever take Battlestar Galactica off of streaming? Seminal classic. I wish I could watch it again right now, but I can't watch this on my American Netflix right now. No Battlestar Galactica for me or anyone else in America that isn't using a VPN to Sweden. Okay, there, we got a nice set choice function. This is part of my new class here called interface. I'm abstracting the menu code so I can reuse this in the main menu and on the pause menu in the game. And this is now a function where you can move the cursor and animate everything and do it all. And it's nice function. How does this work in C++? This, yeah, Saladong's got you there. This refers to the object the method is part of, exactly. Yep. Okay, now I need to make sure the whole menu can start working with this this new system. This is where it's like moving the control, updating the controller bindings and all that. Here's where it steps the cursor. It might actually be wise to change the choices to a map. That would make it really safe, even if you used a crazy-ass choice value. Or I could write a get choice function. Nice, Zilton. Everything's corrupted. Step, step, move the cursor, stop moving, and it's just choice, that choice. And then here. Interface.setChoice. New choice, interface.choice plus step. Erasing. And that moves the cursor, and we'll play the cursor sound as well. Slowly backs away. You get it, Rocket Bunny. You understand what this means. It's a basic thing. Give it a day, man. Do you want me to test that? All right, I'll test it. I'll type this in right now. I'm pretty sure the universe is gonna implode, though. Don't blame me if the stream goes out. I think what you meant was define lowercase if here, but I'm gonna leave it as you told me. Let's see what happens when I try and compile that. Yeah, see, when I compile that, nothing changed because I if is got a capital I. If I change it back to what you I think you meant, a lowercase I. That's gonna mess everything up. Yeah, see, so there you go. This is your code in action. This is what happened. It gave me use of undeclared identifier B. Do you understand why? It's because when you write a macro like this, you need to enclose B and A in parentheses. So there, I'll put B in a parentheses for you. Let's see if it works now. Now it's like use of undeclared identifier B, because once again, B is not there. B is nothing. You can't just replace something, some code, and then hope that it just has, you know what I mean? A's got to be some. You could go like this. You could go if A, B. But that's just going to be fine because, wait, no, it's not. Yeah, so now basically we redefined if to have to take two arguments. So. Here, maybe you meant this. Maybe you meant if not A, if A equals A, if not B, or not A. There, now it's only taking one argument. Now it's like using the result of an assignment as a condition without parentheses. It's giving up on you, man. It is not liking this at all. Anyways, that was fun. All right. So we got the update function here. We're stepping the choice, moving the cursor. Yes, come up with some better. Oh yeah. But I was just like, it's just gonna keep doing this. There's gonna be one more little error, one more little error, because this code is nonsensical. Yes, that's a good word for it. That's a good phrase. Oh, is that what it is? Just a weird Objective-C thing? I think the update function is working now, so let's go to the sh this is the show menu function. Hide the title. Play the dialog open. I think this should be interface.create right here. Given the parent of this, or no, the window actually is probably what. No. Yeah, title layer. And zero on the duration. Maybe, I don't know. There. So going into the create method. It also needs to create all the choices. Oh, I did. Nice. We got choices all well and good. The menu is visible. Let's just set visible true, be explicit about it. And we want to, let's make sure the choice is zero when we create. Actually, no, that's fine. You're trying to decide whether to set up OpenGL or make a class for math stuff. If a built-in trap. What's built-in trap? Zilton, you can't have you can't have the word then without defining it. Then is not actually a word. It's not a keyword. Define if a built-in. I've never even seen this function before. What is this? It compiles. It's like, sure. Hey, what's the grog? What's up? Oh, it's a clang method? Which is here to abort the program by executing an illegal command. Oh, you want to define then as if. So it basically just dereferences a null pointer. Ah. Eh. All right. Zilton's got one more. This is the only one I'm trying, though, Zilton. Wait. Oh, man, I already closed it. If a... Nah. Mr. Fu chat. God damn it, it doesn't have the last fuck. If not a, then a equals b. Once again, there's no b, man. You haven't defined b. I don't know why I'm doing this. This doesn't make sense, man. Doesn't make sense. There's no B. All right. This show menu method, this might need to be, oh yeah, okay, this is interface.create, this all should be interface.clear. And hide menu should be the same thing, or in hide menu should also call clear. Yeah. Interface.clear. There. We don't need remove item anymore. My aim is to make nonsensical code. All right, man, you got to try it out in your own compiler. So this it's calling remove item down here and show the erase menu. And so I need some kind of method inside the interface which can remove an item, squish it out, do any animations it needs to do when it removes an item. Oh yeah, so interface, we don't need this anymore. This is now interface.back. Interface.extra items. Choices push back. No need to create the current choice. Ali Lazo, you're using Love2D, right? No, I'm not using Love2D. I'm using Cocos2DX. Okay, I think this should be good. Yeah, Rocket Bunny, you're starting to understand. You're starting to understand. Oh, thanks, Ali Lazo. So this is mostly a code stream. Today I'm refactoring the menu. I'm making it so I can use the menu in both the main menu and the in-game menu. So I'm abstracting code here, making it so I can reuse the same code. And so I'm going into some code I wrote a long time ago to do the main menu, and I'm just making it better, making it reusable. So it's mostly code. I'm just refactoring stuff to make this all work with this new little kind of like mini class called interface. Show save game menu. This hide menu. Erasing equals false. Okay, so it's creating a choice there. Looping over the save games, creating choices. Here's the callback for this choice. If it has the slot, there's a menu item create callback, which does all this stuff to just, that's drawing a single slot. And then it pushes back the choice. You're counting up this number of save games. Pushing back that, pushing back the exit. And then it goes show menu, and show menu goes interface.clear, interface.create. So interface.create will Oh, wait. This is setting all the positions of the choices. And it's like overriding the size for them all as well. Which is what? What is the size? Man, this is a long method. Pause starts at the middle. Where do we get the variable size? Oh, that's the size of the whole, man. It's the size of the whole screen. All right, so I think I'm just going to go with choice.pause.is0. Or if it's anything other than zero, we just continue. This thing already has its position set, so we're not gonna set it twice. This is just setting the position for like keyboard entries. Really, all this code needs to move into the very method where I create a keyboard interface, and not here in this method. But I can work on that when I get to that part. So this needs to be interface.setChoice0. And this bit, it needs to guarantee that the cursor is visible. Cursor set visible, true. Hey, what's up, Fears? Okay, so now we're on to game mode menu, right? This is save game menu. I just looked that one over. Here's the show game mode menu. It also hides the menu, sets the interface.back, puts, oh yeah, I already did this one. The mega seed menu, interface.back, hide menu. This is where it creates all these letters. Pushes back its choices. Oh, right, now we need to remove item function. Okay, removing an item. Thank you. 3 a.m. there? What time is it here? It's almost 5 o'clock here. The West Coast of America. Remove choice. Int. Choice. If choice is less than zero, or choice is greater than or equal to the number of choices we already have, then we can't do this. Otherwise, we're going to get an iterator. Oh, wait, remove choice. Let's make this a method so it's not yelling at me. My code's yelling at me. Code is yelling at me. Oh, my God. I'm sorry, code. I didn't mean it, code. There we go. All right, so it auto it equals choices dot oh, choices dot begin plus choice. It's 1 a.m. and the builders are still building. It's a little overly pedantic here to go to check for that, but I'm checking for choices that end anyways. And then C dot becomes it, blah, blah, blah. It dereference operator. There needs to be like a better, oh, we need a duration to remove the choice for. Whoops. Remove choice, int choice, float, duration. If there's any overhead associated with auto, I don't think so. I think it's just a compiler thing, right? It's just syntactic sugar. The compiler does it for you. I don't think there's any overhead. But let's check that. That's a good question. This isn't really talking about overhead, I guess. She's talking about readability. Yeah, I don't think there's any overhead, man. Oh, here, wait, performance. Performance. Does auto in C++ make compile time longer? Okay, I don't think you were talking about compile time, but then I guess you consider that part of performance anyways, right? Yeah, this is not going to make it compile longer. Otto is one character longer than int, so the lexer definitely has to do more work. Okay, maybe the lexer. On the other hand, the compiler no longer has to check that the user provided an appropriate type, so my best guess is that Otto will be slightly faster. Oh. And then you should probably not decide when type inference and explicit type based on a performance. Yes, agreed. Anyways, yeah, I'm pretty sure it's a totally syntactic sugar thingy. Just like lambdas are syntactic sugar. Yeah, you're thinking in runtime. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. Yep. It's just a language thing. Nothing to do with runtime. Okay, yeah, up here we need to use this. Oh no, this is gonna break it. Damn, I can't use this. Oh, I guess I can use while. It equals choices.erase. Okay, which means that this needs would be smarter now if it actually returned a bool. Bool, remove choice, so we can be smarter about what we do after we call remove choice. Bool, remove choice, and then if it failed, it returns false. If it succeeded, it returns true. And then we can loop over, like, we can do, like, for int I is less than 100, we should never do this more than 100 times. And this remove choice I duration. There should always be days where you take a break and just stream a movie on Netflix. And just chill and talk. Oh, you mean on like programming days? Look who's back. Hey, what's up, Liver Mortis? Okay, so now I can remove choices from an interface. So going to, where is this? So erase menu. We can erase choices now. You're gonna get 5 points of Bapu. Time to watch coding instead of doing it myself. Nice, man. What kind of code do you do, Liver Mortis? What is it that you code? What language do you work in? If you could tell us, if you would have to shoot us, I understand you can't tell us things you would have to shoot us for, but like, you could at least tell us what language you work with, right? Interface that remove choice, choices that size, minus one. Flow duration, hide menu duration. I think I work in location-based services on Node.js. Oh, cool. Node.js. Nice. I like Node.js. I wrote a whole thing in Node. I wrote a thing that compiles Cocos 2DX. In Node.js, it's called Rapid Game. It's on GitHub. But yeah, I digress. You finally got your mod to work? Awesome! Okay, so interface, remove choice, interface.choices, dot size. All right, so Livermortis and anybody else that's just joined the stream, what I'm working on today is mostly code thing where I'm refactoring the menu code so it can run in both the main menu and the in-game main menu. So I'm removing, coupling, I'm making my code more cohesive. And then you'll be able to access the menu within the game, which would be freaking awesome. Like if you want to go change the sound volume or you want to rebind your controller, you can still do that while you're in the game. You don't have to exit to the main menu. So this is removing all three of the last choices. And it's removing the menu item and then removing the choice. So I want to make sure this is removing the menu item. This does remove the label, and squish removes the menu item, and removes the choice. So yeah, this is good. The same thing as what this is doing here. So yeah, we remove all three of the back choices. It's the first time you're doing real stuff in Node.js. You're learning a lot? Cool. Awesome. The thing I like most about Node.js is that you can just quickly create a little console and run JS code that fast. And it's pretty neat that there's so many different people collaborating on different little, bits of code that work so well with Node.js. NPM, for example, NPM itself is like its own universe of code sharing. It's pretty cool. Fears, will there be different endings to, you mean for Songbringer, or are you talking about for Zilton's thing? Oh yeah, I know Node.js. Oh, do you get used to using callbacks? Promises are for? What are promises? What's a promise? Because I agree. When you write like asynchronous code, it can become a nested mess quite fast. What is a Node.js promise? Consider the following synchronous JavaScript function to read a file and parse it as JSON. Simple and easy to read, but you wouldn't want to use it in most applications as it's blocking. Okay. To make our application performant and respond, wait. Wizard Fu, you should do a vlog about the make on. The making of the game. That's what this is, man. You're watching the vlog. All of these are updated to YouTube. This is you're watching a live vlog. I mean, an actual behind the scenes that come only with the special game edition. It's you're seeing behind the scenes already, man. There's no way I could pull that off because I'm already giving everybody for free the behind the scenes. You're looking at the behind the scenes of making Songbringer right now. Yep. You make it all asynchronous. Right. Yep. Read the file when it's done. Blah blah blah. The extra callback parameter confuses our idea. What is input? What is return value? We need to handle errors thrown by parse. We also need to be careful not to handle errors thrown by the callback function. And by the time it's done, it's a mess. Right. despite all this mess of error handling code, we are still left with the problem of the extra callback parameter hanging around. Promises help you naturally handle errors and write cleaner code by not having callback parameters. Okay, tell me what a promise is then. What is a promise? The core idea behind a promise is that a promise represents the result of an asynchronous. Promise represents the result of an asynchronous operation. Pending. Okay. Fulfilled. Rejected. Once a promise is fulfilled or rejected, it's immutable. Constructing a promise. Once all the APIs return promises, it should be relatively rare that you need to construct one by hand. In the meantime, we'll need a way to polyfill existing APIs. For example, readfill, return new promise. EDRJR, you're saying async await is the future. Is that some? Is that kind of like an option or a different kind of thing for promises? Zilton, I never said 10,000 points would get you a character. I said keep going. You need to keep adding more zeros. Yeah, but it still has lots of error handling code. Totally. Okay, I'm still not getting really what a promise is. Anyways, I can't really do this right now. Oh, I get it. I kind of get it now. You called dot then. Hold on, let me explain to me the dot then part. Following our example through, what we really want to do is transform the promise via another operation. In our case, the second operation is synchronous, but it might just easily have been asynchronous. Fortunately, promises have a fully standardizable method for transforming promises and chaining operations. Put simply, dot then, use dot then whenever you're going to do something with the result, even if that's just waiting for it to finish, and use dot done whenever you aren't planning on doing anything with the result. Okay. Now we can rewrite our original example as simply read JSON file name, read file, dot then, function. Okay. I still don't really understand, but oh well. Whoa, back to the code I was writing. Yes, yeah, at least 100,000. At least 100,000, man. So it blocks? Really? Is that all it does? It just blocks until it returns? Right. If it just blocks, then it's I don't see how it's any advantage. But the dot, if it just calls dot then when you're done, but doesn't that block if you're waiting for dot then? Oh, it waits. Oh, okay. It just waits, though. Yeah. So it does. Okay. So it waits, and it returns when dot then is done, basically. So it's just kind of. I get it. I get it now. It's just kind of a nicer way to write asynchronous code. Okay. Okay, so show erase menu. We create a choice. So the erase choice, push it back. Interface.create. We don't want to call interface create again. So essentially it makes you not have to have callback pyramids of doom, right? Yeah. Okay, where it's creating choices. So I guess I should make my create function smarter so that it can either create a cursor if it needs to. Yeah, let's do it that way. So there's no assertion here. It just checks if cursor is null, then it creates the cursor. So this can be called multiple times. And if the menu is null, again, just creates the menu on the fly, adds it to the parent. And choices, for every choice, it goes and runs through all its choices. And like if the choice has already been created, so if c.menu item is not equal to null pointer, or c.label is not equal to null pointer, then it continues. So it's not gonna go and create a choice twice. There you go. So now this is safe to be called over and over and over. We call this function a bajillion times and be fine. Good. Okay. So going back to the show erase menu. It's once it's done removing choices and adding on a choice to the menu, it can call interface.create. Okay. Show menu duration. I don't know what this is supposed to be. And we don't need to move the cursor or anything because, well, wait, actually, interface.set choice to be zero. Erasing. Okay, I think that's right. We're getting closer to actually being able to run code today. I'm doing a big old refactor on this menu today, refactoring the code so it can run in both the main menu and in the in-game. Am I playing Monopoly? Promises can be a bit confusing to get your head around first, but they're a bit tricky to use until you really get used to them, I've found. Huh. It was played on a circular board? Was it really? Okay, so show erase confirm menu. I just realized that interface.clear shouldn't be called from show menu. Should be called from each one of these individual show functions. So it hides the existing menu or whatever. Huh. Hide menu. Does that clear? Hide menu just calls dialog close, animates the closing of the window, and clears the interface. I think it's smarter to call interface.clear explicitly. There we go. Okay, that's all done. I just clicked 200 points. Wow. You broke your pinky toe once again today? Oh, man. That hurts. Yeah, we call it the pinky toe. Yeah, the smallest one. No way. The first 5,000 copies of Monopoly were played on a circular board? Oh, my God. What? They played Monopoly on a pizza pizza. They should have called it Pizza Napoli. You threw your back out? Oh, I threw my back out last week. I don't know how it happened. Just over the day, as the day went on, my back got hurtier and hurtier. And I'm like, ow, it really hurts now. And the next day, I could hardly even breathe. But luckily, I did some stretching and everything's fine now this week. So it only lasted like 3 days of pain. But man, it sucks, right? It sucks like hurting yourself. Whoa, you've never had a broken bone besides that one toe, but now you've broken it 7 times? That's crazy. Oh, re-injury. Yeah, re-injury sucks the worst. You have to like baby your injury to help it get better. I had tendonitis in this left hand for so long, over a year of tendonitis, and I could not get rid of it because I had to code anyways. Just had to keep coding. Erase confirm. Why is this not right? Oh, because it's interface. Bad choices. Eventually, that toe will become indestructible. I know, right? Like Beethoven going deaf? Exactly. And he still made great work, didn't he? After he became deaf? Or was he deaf the whole time? Can't remember. But yeah, going blind as a coder, yeah. So we're removing the back choice, interface.removeChoice, interface.choices.size, -1. Pushing back this extra interface item, which says, are you sure? We don't ever need to call create choice anymore. interface.create. Interface set choice. All right, so we're on to the settings menu. Wow, so as far as you know, the Ninth Symphony was composed entirely after he lost his hearing. Wow. Okay, so we're hiding the menu, clearing the existing interface, setting the back button. Man, when I finally run this code, this is probably not going to work. Probably going to be something just wrong somewhere because this is a major refactor. But once this is all refactored and done, it'll be really nice to be able to access the menu from the in-game. Here's a lot of code I'm reusing. I need to create a function for this. And show menu calls dialog, bring up the menu, create the choices if they're not needed, create set choice, thank the backers. Cool. Okay, and I think this is show controller menu. Yeah, show controller menu is getting close to being finished finally. So if interface.choice or cursor is not equal to null, then we're going to hide the current cursor. Rockabunny, platformer mockup. It's loading, but it's not loaded. It's like all white. Is it all white? Is it just a white image? Can't just be a white image. It's not loading for me, buddy. Is that image all right? Oh my God, two times a week, a full day without feeling in that arm? Man. Jeez, that's crazy. Oh my God, finally got through all that code. All right, so what do we got? Why is this remove item duration? Oh yeah, remove item duration. Okay, here we go. Finally, we're running the code. First time all stream that I'm actually going to run some code. Let's hope it doesn't break. To give yourself a stranger. Oh my god, it works! No way! Oh, it even goes to the next menu! Oh! I can't believe this worked on the first try! Look how well it's actually working. It's gone into three different menus now. You can go backwards in menus. I can even press the B button to go back. Oh, sweet. All the way back in the main menu. I can't read this, though. Does cancella mean erase? I think cancella means erase. Impostazioni means settings. Whoa, look at this. Even these work. Oh my god, this might be the first time in history I've done a huge code refactor and there weren't any obvious horrible bugs. Reset la configuration. Oh, this is resets bindings. Add new bindings. Wow, I'm impressed. Why is the menu eating? Why is my GPU going crazy though? That menu is way suboptimal. Something is wrong with that. I know, and it just worked. It just worked. Did you guys just see that? Like, it worked on the code the whole stream, and it just worked. I feel like I'm living in some weird world where like Moore's laws do not apply. Zildan, there's nothing new. There's nothing new yet. Yeah, refactoring means nothing new. Yeah. It was always like that. It was always like that. Nothing has actually changed to the user, the player. But things have changed a lot on the underneath. And I do believe this is a good place to check in. I'm going to check this in because that all worked. And I'm sure there's some bugs in there. There's got to be something wrong with that. But I'll figure that out. I just need to check this so far in. So what I did was I created a choice thing and made that accessible pretty much anywhere. And then there's interface. I guess interface should move into extensions pretty soon. But I'll do that later. So, yeah, I created this interface class. Yes, I did a bunch of code to do nothing more efficiently. Exactly. But in a second, you'll see why I did it. I did it so that I can access that same menu inside the game. So when you're playing the game, you're running around, you're fighting enemies and stuff, and you access the pause menu, there'll be three choices now where you can go to the settings. You can go like, okay, I'm playing the game. I go to my settings. I can change the sound volume while you're in the game. And right now, I would have to go write a whole bunch more code if I were to do it with my existing old code. So I refactored it so that I can reuse code. Oh, cool. You put it on Twitter? Nice. Oh, yeah, it's working on here. Nice. Oh, this is your mock-up? Cool, man. Right on. What are all these little... Are these little doors or are those windows? Oh, I'm not signed into Twitter on there. I was going to click like. I'm going to click like anyways. I like that. Right on, Rugabunny. Okay, so yeah, this interface has a clear method, a remove choice method, a create method. This worked on the first try? What? It's like getting a hole in one in golf. It's like, what? A squirrel didn't help me out? Moving the cursor. Removing all that code that didn't really belong in the title scene. That's going to be abstracted to be used anywhere. Oh, they're picture frames. Cool. Want to see the final boss for my game? Cool, man. I like it. Nice. I like it a lot. I know that I have to set up OpenGL, but I don't want to. Oh. Oh. Maybe there's a little library you can use or something. So I always look over my code before I check it in. I always just kind of like double check, make sure what I'm not checking in anything that I didn't mean to check in. You know, there's a lot of times when you're working on code and things get dirty and you're like, okay, you need to kind of clean up your work a bit, throw away the, it's just like construction. It's like construction. You have all this trash that kind of gets trashed over your construction site and you got to go clean up the trash basically. Before the client comes or whatever. So that's kind of what I'm doing here. I'm basically cleaning up code base, just making sure that it's not too dirty. Because if I did leave some kind of dirty piece of code in there, it could lead to a bug later on. Or it could just be hiding a bug that's already there. You know what I mean? Yep, it already is a library, but there's probably a library that can use that library and make the library easier to use. Because OpenGL is a C-based, and it's kind of, it's not exactly easy. It's not exactly an easy library to use. Cool. Check it in. Okay, so I think the next thing I want to do is there's this bit where it sets all these positions and it doesn't need to. Where does it do that? Oh, in show menu. Cool, I'm checking it out. Discord, if you're unable to open the app, copy the invite code. What's Discord? Oh, Discord's that thing, right, where you can share stuff. How do I click on this? Okay, so it's a whisper. I'll check out the whisper link later on. Also in the title scene.h, I need to remove this stuff I don't need anymore. Blam! And this. All right. Okay, so this bit, it's going and applying a bunch of positions and stuff to choices. And I think if I removed all this, it would only mess up the keyboard menu when you're entering in your world seed. I'm hoping. I need to change my language back to English because I can't read Italian. Right on, man. Okay, so that didn't work either. Oops, I exited. One, two, three, four. Nope. So I guess there were a few other positions that were, it was using that automatic method. One, two, three. Oh yeah, there's a lot that's not. Okay. It is. Esperanto translation win? What's? Okay, so that confirmed that basically there are things that are using this automatic positioning. I guess maybe there should be a method within interface which just goes ahead and automatically sets all the positions to whatever is should be appropriate. So if it detects that it's a keyboard, it'll put on the keyboard positions. Otherwise, nah, that's just not right. I just designed this whole system so that it can have that each choice has a position, so I might as well take advantage of it and use the system the way it is. All right, so I need to make sure that every one of the current menus uses these positions instead of relying on this whole automatic positioning here. You're going to add seeds with challenges. What do you mean, seeds with challenges? You mean like achievements? There are, yes, going to be achievements. And I'll be working on achievements this week, actually. All those belong down there, I think. Like certain seeds have challenges. Why wouldn't all seeds have challenges? What do you mean by challenges? So So see, Zilton would disable the ability to walk normally, forcing you to walk diagonally, and monsters are bugged out and they have mixed abilities. I don't know. I would, if I were to do that, right? I would. What if somebody plays that? What if somebody plays the world Zilton and isn't expecting that challenge? They're gonna be like, "Oh my God, this game is fucked up. All I can do is walk diagonally," and they would have no clue. So there would need to be some kind of way that the player would have to choose that. So, for example, the player could walk into a certain cave and activate a challenge, but you know, I think designing the game so that every certain seeds have specific challenges like that completely change the game would be a bad idea for the game. But if it were a choice that the player had that they could enable it themselves somehow, then it would be good. Okay, let's just do this. Starting with the save game menu. Allows seed specific challenges, but then how is a regular player going to know what that means? If it's the first time you've ever played Songbringer and you're going in, you already have the choice between regular and permadeath mode, and you have no clue what that means. You have no clue what most people are going to have no clue what that means. Regular, permadeath, I don't know. They're going to be probably scared by the word permadeath, so they're not going to choose permadeath, so they're going to choose regular. Putting another choice in there, like allows seed specific challenges, whatever the heck that vague statement means to somebody that hasn't ever played the game before, I don't think it's a good idea, man. But like I said, if you made it so the player could walk into a cave inside that any world and enable seed specific challenges in the game by their own volition, I think that would be a good choice. But still, it's not a high priority. Yeah, exactly, Saladong. It's a good point. Saladong's puts it quite realistically there. It is a very, very low return on invested time and something that not everybody's going to see. Director, get instance, get window size. Oh yeah, this is getting to be messed up, man. So maybe this should be an automatic method, just the way it is. Because this is based on the window size right here. There you go. That's a great way to do it, right? If you defeat the last enemy in your game, it unlocks a super hard mode. Sure, that's great. This doesn't confuse your existing players. Yes, economizing your time. Yeah. You have to budget the time you have before release well, so you end up with a game that will sell well. True. You have to budget your time well. You have to spend your time on the important things first. Okay, this needs to be like a variable inside title scene that has the size of its window. So interface vec2 window size. And then we can just know the window size anywhere. So we've got the wind size, we've got a pixel. And then we can set window size dot set. There, now we know how big the window is going to be for this title thing. Let them suffer. There we go. Okay, so now we got a window size variable. And like things like the show menu can use it. But we're gonna use that in a minute. We're gonna go to show save game menu, and now we can use this. No need to mess with this stuff. So this is definitely not the keyboard. Choices are definitely not less than or equal to 4. Pause that x minus equals window size dot x. This is window size dot y. You don't need this code either, is keyboard. So it boils down to this, looping over the positions and setting the height and the position and stuff. So it's just like this, setting the pause. And what would happen if every and was replaced with or? I'm getting hungry too, Bafu. That means it's probably 2 hours pretty soon. So this stream is getting close to being done. But I got some more juice in me. I can keep coding for a minute here before I need to juice up. So the current choice is C. C dot pause. Where did C come from? Oh, yeah, okay, I get it. It's, we got C. We're setting its position. Now C dot size equals, or size, what's the width per item? Size dot set. I'm not sure what the width is supposed to be. Num is less than num save games. Of course, all these are save games. This is hyper slot. Wait. Yeah, hyper slot. Pause dot y minus equals c dot size dot y. What's up, Kovarni? Pound defined and equals no. Yeah, there you go. Okay, so now what I'm doing here is I'm setting the position and size of each button or each choice that's being created in this interface. And then later on, it goes and creates some more save choices. So height per slot is 36 times pixel, and we don't need that variable anymore. Hyper item will be used later. The width though, what's the width supposed to be? Oh, it's way too big. Win size times 0.8, that's wrong. Pretty sure that it's setting that. Yeah, it's setting size, totally. Whoa, That's wrong. So I guess that was never right. Actually, no, that does make sense. For the big old slots like that? Yeah, okay, that makes sense. So if it's a giant save game slot, it's kind of the whole width. So we're gonna go the window size dot width or dot x. There we go. Okay, we've now set the position and the size of all the save game choices here in the menu. And slowly but surely, I'm getting rid of this old janky code, which was kind of mishmashed together. So a rig X is not used. All right, now pause can be simplified. Pause dot X equals 0 minus. So this is pause dot X is minus window size dot X times a half plus menu in text indent times pixel menu size or pause dot y is just window size dot y times a half minus 15 times pixel. There, simplified that, but pixel needs to be above there. Okay. Now down to these other items, like showing the erase button, the settings button, and the exit button. All of these need positions and stuff. C dot pause equals pause, C dot size dot set. These are smaller choices. I'm not sure what to make of these, but we'll call it 50 dot times, or maybe 100. You want to see that? All right, here. Defined and or. Oh, it doesn't like it. It's not allowing you to redefine something that's not an identifier. An identifier is something like if or void or backer label or anything that's actually a word. This is a language. This is part of the language, so you can't change it. If Jerome buys four watermelons for $10 each and one copy of BBW Beauties for $5, what is he? And here's where size per is like 21 per pixel. C dot pause equals pause, C dot size dot set, and then pause dot wise. Okay, this should all be together. Nah. Looks better like that. He's obviously rich. Obviously. All right. So we refactored one of those screens. So now if I go back here and comment out all this code. We should at least have the first menu working now. A watermelon enthusiast? Damn. Okay, it didn't work. Let's find out. I'll slip into the code. Show save game menu. Wait, is that right? Is it supposed to start with zero or whatever? Oh, it might need to start with the middle of the window. Hold on. Show menu. Oh yeah, pause starts with the middle of the window. Plus some weirdness. I like my answer more. Working as intended. That's yeah. Bam. Ship it. That was looking great. What are you talking about? That was looking awesome. Okay, so pause is supposed to start like window size that width times a half. No, win size that width times a half. Okay, so hopefully this time. But what if all and was replaced with or? You could easily find out. How could I easily find out? It's closer. All right, at least it's on the screen now. So I got the math wrong again. There's something wrong with the positions here. Okay, so what's wrong with the math? It wasn't far enough to the left. And it wasn't high enough up. You want me to just do a, you mean a search and replace? No, I'm not gonna do that, man. I'm not gonna do that right now. It would take forever. I've already spent the entire stream refactoring code. I'm not gonna refactor something just to see what replacing and with or does. Which we all know would just mess everything up. I I do not get this. This is wind size dot width times a half minus window size times a half. Wait a minute, does that mean that this is just supposed to be menu indent? Like, is it a child of its parent, maybe? What if this was 0? Okay, so no, putting the position at 0 puts it right on the very left of the screen. Ah, that's it. I don't know. I've kind of lost my steam now at this point. Can't keep coding. I gotta stop at this point. So that's gonna be it for today's stream. My next goals will be to basically just make this new code work better with the new system, and that's one of the things I'm trying to do is make all the positions line up. So the entity that's responsible for setting window positions is the thing that's managing the interface, not the interface itself. So this will eventually simplify everything, but it's going to take some work to get all this math right, once again, as it was working. So anyways, that's it for today's stream. Yeah, totally. Exactly. Yep. I'm going to get some dinner and go back to this tonight, and it'll be easy at that point. But so far, this refactor has gone pretty well. Most of the code's already refactored. It's just now the point of just getting some positions dialed in, and so that's all working basically optimally. So that, not optimally, but like, it's just more cohesive code. But yeah, see you guys. Do I have everything in two files? What are you talking about?